السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى أزواجه وذريته كما صليت على آل إبراهيم، وبارك على محمد وعلى أزواجه وذريته كما باركت على آل إبراهيم، إنك حميد مجيد. أما بعد، إن شاء الله we are back to our book الداء والدواء, the disease and the cure by الإمام ابن القيم عليه رحمة الله. After mentioning a good number of ahadith that will instill fear in the hearts of the believers from the punishment of Allah سبحانه وتعالى, الإمام ابن القيم continued to criticize and critique the people who are fooled, the people who are deceived. And last time he spoke about those who are fooled and deceived by the immediate worldly pleasures. Those who say, ذَرَّةٌ مَنْقُودَةٌ, you give me a very little thing, an atom that is cash in advance, is better than دُرَّةٌ مَوْعُودَةٌ, a jewel, a pearl that is just a promise. They want something that is quick and fast. They don't want to wait. And the one who says that the worldly joys and pleasures, we are certain of these. We are sure we can use them, we can enjoy them. But then the enjoyments of the next life, we are not sure about that. We have doubt in this. So he mentioned that this is the shaitan that is confusing them, the shaitan that is perplexing them, mixing them up, getting them confused to think in this way. As for those who say, give me cash, I want immediate pleasures, I don't want something that is just promised later on, and that if what you get immediately is better than what is delayed, what is postponed, the answer to that is, if النقد والنسيئة متساويان, if the cash payment and the deferred payment, they are equal in amount, then maybe you would say you want the cash, right? The cash is better. But then if they are the amounts are very much different and the postponed payment is far higher than the cash advance amount, then the postponed payment is better, definitely. Then how is it then, the Sheikh inquires, الدنيا كلها من أولها إلى آخرها كنفس واحد من أنفاس الآخرة. How is it then, if you want to compare cash and postponed, how is it then, we mentioned that the later payment, if it is more, it's better than the cash. So how about then if all of the life of this world, all of it, from beginning to end, yani the life of all of the humans, from the very beginning of it to its end, is not even equal to one breath from the breaths of the next life. So then, if this is what we say about all of this life, then what is the comparison then to your lifespan compared to the next life? Yani, how many is the worldly life? Millions and millions of trillions of years? Okay, how much would you live? It's 60 or 70. 60 or 70 years. So if all of the worldly life is not even worth, it cannot even be compared to one breath of the breaths of the next life, then what about your lifespan? How does it compare to the next life if you compare cash and postponed deferred payments? Definitely the next life is far better. And he mentioned the ahadith pertaining to that, that this worldly life compared to the next life is nothing but like when you dip your finger in the sea and then take it out. Look how much you get back from it. How much water will stick on your finger if you dip your finger in the sea. How much did you diminish of the sea water? How much of the sea water did you take away? It is actually nothing. So the wise will prefer al-ajil, what is postponed, the next life, over what is immediate, al-ajil. Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As for the one who says we are sure about the worldly joys, but we are in doubt about the enjoyments of the next life. Now this person is either a believer or a disbeliever. If he's a disbeliever, it's understood, right? Because he does not believe in the next life. But if he is a believer, then his situation is very sad. And they are called believers and disbelievers. They are called to reflect about the life of this world, the human. Look within your own self and reflect and ponder and think, and you will reach that a conclusion that there must be a creator. And that creator, it is not fitting for him to create and neglect the creation that he created. He doesn't command them, he doesn't forbid them, he just creates them and just leaves them and abandons them. It's not suitable, it's not fitting for him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, he must have sent messengers. And those messengers, they came with revelation. And based on following the messengers and the revelations, or denying the messengers and the revelations, disbelieving in them, there will be reward and punishment. And therefore, there will be a next life. He said, if you have a king, or from the kings of this world, he has a big kingdom, a vast kingdom. He has subjects and he has, lands and he has people. And then this king, he doesn't care what those people do in the land. He does not have any soldiers or police or to make sure that he does not command them, he does not forbid them. He doesn't care if they look after themselves or they don't look after themselves. If they oppress one another or if they are kind to one another. Just a king who is just living his own life. He doesn't care about anyone. This king definitely will be judged to be a foolish person. He's not a wise person. He's not a wise king. So if a human being, it does not fit one like him, like a king, to be acting like in this way, very passive, right? Just letting everything go the way it wants to go, right? Then what about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the king of kings, subhanahu wa ta'ala, Malik al-Muluk? It's not fitting for him that he will just create and abandon, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said then, if you reflect upon yourself, you yourself, the human, right? From the beginning of your creation, from the time when you are a sperm, up until you became a complete human being, you matured, then it will become clear to you that the one who took good care of you, this diligent care of you that he took care of you in this way, he moved you from one stage to another, from one stage to another, from one period to another, right? From one situation to another, one state to another. It is not fitting and it is not suitable that he will just ignore you and abandon you, right? After he took this very much diligent care, very exacting care about all of the aspects of your life from the time when you are a sperm, right? So if you reflect upon this, the true reflection, he said, then everything you see And he said, even things you do not see. ما تبصر وما لا تبصر. Whatever you see and whatever even you do not see will be a proof, will be evidence upon three things. التوحيد, النبوة, المعاد. التوحيد, the oneness of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. النبوة, prophethood. And المعاد, resurrection. Going back, there will be a next life. You will be resurrected. After you die, it's not the end. It's just the beginning of another world. Right? And those three issues, التوحيد, النبوة, المعاد, these all the revelations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, all the books that Allah sent, all of them agree on those three items. التوحيد, the oneness of Allah. النبوة, prophethood, messengers, that Allah sends messengers with revelations. And المعاد, the next life. All of them agree on that. You have some people who nowadays they refer themselves to the people of the book, who say, you know, paradise is our world. This earth will become paradise because there will be no fighting, there will be no problems, and so on and so forth, right? They believe somehow in next world, but then the same world that we are in, yani, right? They claim that they are from the people of the book, but they are a new sect that came up, you know, just the last century. Otherwise, all of the revelations that Allah revealed, all of them agree on these three points. And I did mention before that Al-Imam Al-Shawkani alayhi rahmatullah, he authored a nice booklet that my intention inshallah is for us to go through that booklet. And he quotes from the Quran and also from the previous books, proving these three items. At-Tawheed, the oneness of Allah, that all of the revelations, all of the books of Allah, they call to worshipping Allah alone without any partner. That He is the creator, and He is only one creator, not two or three or ten. He is just one creator. And the one who created all is the one who deserves worship without any partner. And that to Him belongs all the beautiful names and high attributes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second point is messengers, mention of prophets and messengers that Allah sent over the years. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent so many of them. As one of the ahadith in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, it mentions 124,000 prophets and messengers. The messengers amongst these are 315. This number, from 124,000 prophets and messengers. As Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, he was the one who asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam about that. And he answered him in this way, that there are 124,000, the messengers from these are 300 and bid'ata ashar, yani almost 315, 313, 314, something like that. This number, right? The last thing is Al-Ma'ad. So this booklet from Al-Imam Al-Shawkani, as I mentioned, the aim of it, or the purpose he authored it, is to show that the heavenly revealed books, yani, Islam is just one religion, you know, heavenly revealed religions. There are no religions, it's just one religion, right? Yani, there are other man-made religions, right? But then there is one religion, and that is the religion of Islam that is accepted by Allah. And that is the religion of all of the prophets, right? Starting from Adam till Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, all of them. It's only one religion, right? And that is the religion of Islam. And Allah did reveal different legislations to the different prophets. That's where the difference is. Otherwise, the main message was one and the same. The main message was one and the same. And from the main points that all of these revelations agreed on are these three that Al-Imam Al-Qayyim here, he mentioned, and Al-Imam Al-Shawkani wrote a whole book on that. The Sheikh refers, Al-Imam Al-Qayyim refers to his book about the oaths in the Quran. He refers to that book and he mentions the ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِمَا تُبْصِرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears, makes an oath by what we see and what we do not see. وَمَا لَتُبْصِرُونَ إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلُ رَسُولٍ كَرِيمٍ. It is surely the statement of a messenger. That is a noble messenger. Right? Surah Al-Haqqa, ayah 38 to 40. It is a statement of a noble messenger. That is Jibril, alayhi as-salatu was-salam. And it's his statement because he is reciting it. Otherwise, it is whose statement? It's the statement of Allah. That's why he is only a messenger, right? So a messenger stating this statement, which is he got it from Allah. So it is referred to him, the statement of a noble messenger. It is referred to him because he's the one who's delivering it. Right? Otherwise, it is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He also said that we mentioned also a piece of that or some of that at the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Dhariyat 21. وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. And within yourselves, don't you see? And within yourselves, do not you see? Don't you see? Right? So you yourself is a proof. If you just look at yourself, you yourself is a proof. As he says here, أَنَّ الْإِنسَانَ دَلِيلٌ لِنَفْسِهِ عَلَى وُجُودِ خَلِقِهِ وَتَوْحِيدِهِ. The human himself is a proof for his own self, for the existence of his creator and his oneness and the truthfulness of his messengers, صُدْقِ رُسُلِهِ وَإِثْبَاتِ صِفَاتِ كَمَالِهِ, and affirming the attributes, his attributes of perfection. He goes on to say, then it has become clear that al-mudayyi' maghrurun 'ala at-taqdirayn. This one who is negligent, this one who is at loss, he is deceived, he is fooled in whichever estimation we look at it, yani case A or case B, right? Whether we take the estimation that he believes and he has certainty, right? He is a loser then, right? And if we take the case of him being a disbeliever, yani he belies and he has doubts, then he is a loser too. Right? Yani the one who says, yani I am sure and certain of the worldly joys, and I'm not sure about the enjoyments of the next life. Right? The Sheikh, he says, we proved now, if he is a believer, he believes in the next life and the messengers, and he's still, you know, preferring the worldly joys, and he's not sure about the next life, he is a loser. And if he is a disbeliever, he is again a loser, and he is deceived and he is fooled. Now he asks a question, which is yani a real question, and he answers it also in a beautiful way. He says, if you say, كيف يجتمع التصديق الجازم الذي لا شك فيه بالمعاد والجنة والنار ويتخلف العمل. How is it that having certain belief that there is no doubt, yani in that belief that you do not doubt al-ma'ad, this next life, resurrection, and being brought back from the dead, being brought back to life, right? How can this be combined? You have certain faith in resurrection and paradise and the fire, yet your deeds, al-amal, your actions, yani are not actualized, يعني, that your deeds fall behind or lag behind. Someone who believes in the next life, in the paradise and in the fire, and then he doesn't act, he doesn't do the deeds that يعني, are supposed to be implied by his faith, by his belief. His faith and belief should lead him, necessitates that he will do the deeds that will take him to paradise and stay away from the deeds that will take him to the fire, since he's a believer. How is it that he has certain faith in the next life, yet he doesn't act accordingly? He's asking, how does this happen? He said, is it within the human nature, الطباع البشرية, human nature, human habits and customs, that يعلم العبد, that the servant knows that he is summoned, مطلوب, he is summoned, he is called, that tomorrow, غدا, إلى بين يدي بعض الملوك ليعاقبه أشد العقوبة. He is called tomorrow, يعني you have a human being who is being called tomorrow to attend before, to be present in front of a king, and that king will punish him the most severe type of punishment, or that king will honor him the most perfect type of honor, أتم كرامة. Yet you find that person يبيت ساهيا غافلا. He will spend the night before the meeting, يعني neglecting this issue, unaware, you know, just you know, in a slumber, basically doesn't care. He does not remember his standing, his stance before that king. He does not prepare himself for that. He does not take the necessary precautions or the means and the measures and the right preparation for that. Is this, you know, a human, can this be part of the human nature or what? He says, this is a valid question. سؤال صحيح. وارد على أكثر هذا الخلق. This is a valid question that really you can ask to all of these creation. It is a valid question to present to the creation. He said, واجتماع هذين الأمرين من أعجب الأشياء. For these two things to be combined together is from the most amazing things. Right? يعني you have belief, certain faith, and yet you don't act according to your belief. Right? According to your belief. And he gave us this example of the king that he will meet tomorrow, and then you just don't care. That night you spend it unaware. You know, it doesn't matter to you. He says, هذا التخلف له عدة أسباب. This يعني discrepancy between knowledge and belief and action, right? This contradiction between both. تخلف meaning يعني lagging, when you are lagging behind, right? تخلف, you lag behind, you are delayed, people are in front of you and you are behind. You see, like the word خلف and سلف, right? خلف and سلف. سلف who are before, خلف who are later. تخلف here now, تخلف يتخلف. The deeds are lagging behind. They're not actually happening. He means by that, like this now. You have certain belief in something, but your actions do not match what you believe in. So he says it has a number of causes behind it. One of them is ضعف العلم ونقصان اليقين. Having weak knowledge and having shortage, lack of yaqeen, certainty, lack of yaqeen. So you have knowledge, but it's weak knowledge. And you have faith, but you do not have yaqeen. You do not have certainty in faith. He said, وَمَنْ ظَنَّ أَنَّ الْعِلْمَ لَا يَتَفَاوَتْ فقوله من أفسد الأقوال وأبطلها. The one who thinks that knowledge does not vary, then his statement is from the most corrupt statements, most invalid statements. Right? So, as you know, the definition of al-Iman according to Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, right? It has five parts in it. It is belief in the heart, statement by the tongue, actions by the body parts, and it increases by good deeds, and it increases, it decreases by evil deeds, by disobediences, right? Now there is a group that says, you know, Iman is just faith in the heart and statement by the tongue, right? And there are others too, but we are not concerned about the others, right? There are those who say the faith is belief in the heart and statement of the tongue. And they denied that Iman increases and decreases. They say Iman is just one piece. You either have it or you don't have it, right? Now, those who say this, and this is the reason why I mentioned them, because what he said here, this faith in the heart and knowledge in the heart, even that, it increases and decreases, is not the same. Yani if we leave the issue of the body parts, the actions, that they increase the faith or cause it to decrease, right? Let's talk about the faith in the heart, this peace in the heart. This faith in the heart itself, it increases and decreases. It's not the same. It's not the same. And that's why, yani, those who said that other statement, they said Iman is just one thing, you either have it or you don't have it. They say, my Iman is like the Iman of Jibreel. And my Iman is like the Iman of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And my Iman is like the Iman of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Do you think this is true? I don't think they can even imagine this, but if you speak to them, they might, you know, they will find a contradiction within what they are saying, right? Because this is not true, right? Although, yes, we believe in Allah, malaikati, kutubi, rusuli, liyawm al-akhir, qadr, khayri wa shari. We believe in those things, those six pillars of faith. We believe in them, right? But then our belief in those is not the same. It increases and decreases. That's why some of us are more certain, have yaqeen, and some of us don't have as much of that yaqeen. So then you might believe, but your actions are not yani geared towards what you really believe in. They don't match it. Right? Why? Weakness in knowledge. Weakness of the knowledge. He said, Ibrahim al-Khalil, alayhi salatu wassalam, he asked his Lord to show him bringing the dead alive. He asked him to show him that ayanan. He wants to see that with his own eyes. بعد علمه بقدرة الرب على ذلك. After he knew that Allah, the Lord, has the ability to do that. He knows it, right? He knows Allah is able to bring the dead alive, back to life again. He knows that. He still asked to see that with his own eyes, right? And he said, لِيَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي لِيَزْدَادَ طُمَأْنِينَ, so that he will increase in this يعني, comfort, in this certainty of faith, he will be increased by seeing it by his own eyes. He said, وَيَصِيرَ الْمَعْلُومُ غَيْبًا شَهَادَةً. Right? So that what is known, although it is known غَيْبًا, يعني you know it, but you haven't seen it, it will become knowledge that is witnessed. So you have knowledge of the unseen. Right? يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Right? That's what it means, يؤمن بالغيب. غيب is the unseen world from us, the hidden world from us. Anything hidden from you is غيب, right? ما غاب عنك, it's hidden from you. That's why it is called غيب, hidden world. So you believe in that hidden world from you, right? Although it is hidden, you believe in it. But that hidden world could be coming witnessed world, right? Witnessed world. So he is asking, although he knew that Allah is all able to bring the dead alive, he asked to see it with his own eyes so that his iman will increase. And in the seerah book that we are doing, we learned that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the night of al-Isra, he actually went and inside the paradise and he saw things in there and the fire, right, also. And he saw the prophets and he saw the angels, so many things. So this, in his case, alayhi salatu wasalam, haqqul yaqeen, he saw it for his own self. He's very certain of that, alayhi salatu wasalam. So people's faith vary. So if someone has weak knowledge, right, then yes, he knows there is akhirah. He knows he believes in that. There is paradise and the fire. But then his actions are not up to the level of what he believes in. And Al-Imam Ahmad narrated in his Musnad from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he said, لَيْسَ الْمُخْبِرُ كَالْمُعَيْنِ, or لَيْسَ الْمُخْبَرُ كَالْمُعَيْنِ, they differ in, يعني, in one narration, لَيْسَ الْخَبَرُ كَالْمُعَيْنَ, it refers to, يعني, the report is not like seeing with your own eyes. What happened? It's referring to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, when he went and had that appointment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah told him that your people started worshipping the calf, al-ijl. He told him that. So he had the news already. But when he came back and he saw that they are actually worshipping that calf, what happened? He was very angry. And he threw the tablets that Allah has given him out of his anger. Angry for the sake of Allah. As to how dare you worship other than Allah? How dare you worship this calf? Right? Al-ijl. So although he knew, and the report is a report from who? From Allah. So there is no doubt. There is no doubt about it. But when you see for yourself with your own eyes, it's not the same. Report is not like when you see it by yourself. Once again, he's talking about knowledge and the weak knowledge. Yani their knowledge varies in degrees and levels. He goes on to say, فإذا اجتمع إلى ضعف العلم عدم استحضاره. That's why I said it's a very beautiful answer, actually. He said, so if you combine to the weakness in knowledge, you combine, you add to that the fact that you do not recall it. How many times we have a lot of information is stored here, but we don't remember them. Until someone mentions something or remind us, oh, okay, I know that already. You don't need to tell me that. I already know it. Well, you already know it, but you never called it to mind. You're not living this knowledge, right? So imagine someone who has weak knowledge and hardly calls to mind this knowledge, right? Many of us memorize a lot of ayat from the Quran. But then how many times do we recite them? And if we do recite them, how many times we really call to mind the meanings that are contained in there? To a point, يعني, when those shuyukh sometimes they come and they speak, it's as if you heard this the first time in your life. You know it long time, it's as if the first time you hear it. Wallahi, you say, I never, it didn't click like that, right? But it is a reality. So now someone has weak knowledge, then he doesn't call it to mind, right? وغيبته عن القلب في كثير من أوقاته أو أكثرها لاشتغاله بما يضاده. You add to that now that this knowledge that is already weak, hardly being recalled, right? It is absent from the heart in most of the times, right? Most of the in many times or most, he says, كثير or أكثر, most. يعني many times or most of the time this piece of information is absent because he is busy with the opposite, بما يضاده. He is busy with the opposite. If it's the next life, he is busy with the worldly life, completely immersed in that. وانضم إلى ذلك تقاضي الطبع. Now he will mention other things. You add to this now, so you have weak knowledge, you don't recall it, right? And this knowledge is absent from your mind many or most of the time because you are busy with the opposite. Add to that your nature, your custom, your habit necessitates something from you that, you know, this knowledge is put on hold, right? غلبات الهوى. Add to that desires that will beat you, will overcome you. استيلاء الشهوة, lusts and desires. Food, drink, women, this, making money, taking over, right? Over you. وتسويل النفس, تسويل النفس, your soul giving you excuses. No, this is just, no, that is just, you know, next time you can, and the other day you can catch up with this when you, so on and so forth. تسويل النفس, your soul, yourself is giving you excuses and, you know, next time, the other way, like that. And غرور الشيطان, the شيطان working to deceive you and to fool you, right? Sway you, and he dedicated himself for this. Al-gharur, that's what is the shaytan is called. Gharrakum billahi al-gharur, right? The shaytan is al-gharur, is the one who deceives a lot, right? So he is dedicated for that job. واستبطاء الوعد. You have a promise from Allah, but you, يعني, view this promise, yes, it will be fulfilled, but not now. It's postponed, استبطاء. So you view it to be delayed. It's going to take time for this to happen, right? استبطاء الوعد. وطول الأمل, extended hopes. Might think you will live forever, right? Planning for 20 years in the future and 30 years and so on and so forth, right? طول الأمل. ورقدة الغفلة, the sleep of negligence, sleep of being unaware. وحب العاجلة, the love of the immediate worldly pleasures, that is عاجلة, immediate worldly pleasures. ورخص التأويل, the allowances of interpretation, right? Allowance, رخص. It's okay, so and so from the scholars, he said this, is all right, don't worry about this, right? The first home only, right? You can buy the first home, then, you know, right? And the other allowances, right? It's okay, you know, you are in a situation, you are in a this, رخص التأويل, making things allowable for you which are not allowed, right? إلف العوائد, being accustomed to your habits, so much attached to the habits, right? So much attached to the habits. You don't want to break those habits. You don't want to break them, right? He said, now you have weakness of knowledge, hardly recalled that knowledge, hardly being called to mind. It is absent many or most of the time. That weak knowledge is absent most of the time. Then you have all of this. All of this added to that. Your nature, your desire, your lusts, the excuses from yourself, the shaitan that is deceiving and cunning, the promise that you view to be taking long time to take place, the extended hopes that you have, the sleep or the slumber of, you know, negligence and being unaware, the extreme love of the swift, immediate, worldly pleasures, تحبون العاجلة, right? And those allowances, false interpretations, that's halal, that's halal, that's okay, you're all right with that, don't worry about it, right? And being so much attached to the habits that you are already accustomed to. He says, فهناك, at this time then, لا يمسك الإيمان إلا الذي يمسك السماوات والأرض أن تزولا. No one will hold faith, يعني keep it still. No one will hold the faith, يعني it's weak faith already, weak إيمان already, weak knowledge already, and then you have all of these problems pulling, snatching you away from it, right? Then at this case, right, he says, Iman could not stand still, could not be held, right? No one can hold it, no one can keep it for you, except the one who holds and keeps the heavens and the earth from diminishing, from moving, from being, from perishing. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُمْسِكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ أَنْ تَزُولَ. Allah is the one who holds the heavens and the earth. That's why they're not vanishing. وَلَئِنْ زَالَتَ إِنْ أَمْسَكَهُمَا أَحَدٌ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ. If someone else was looking after them, was supposed to hold them, then they would have gone already. Right? يُمْسِكُ السَّمَاءَ أَنْ تَقَعَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ. As in the Quran, Allah holds the heaven from falling down on the earth. Right? So it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who would hold this very weak faith that is being yani bombarded with all of these other kinds of attacks. He said, وَبِهَذَا السَّبَبِ, and because of this reason, يَتَفَاوَتُ النَّاسُ فِي الْإِيمَانِ وَالْأَعْمَالِ. People vary a lot in faith and actions. حتى ينتهي إلى أدنى أدنى مثقال مثقال ذرة في القلب. To a point that the faith will go down and lower and lower and even lower to the least atom's weight of iman, or an ant's weight of iman in the heart. And it will go down and down to a point as described in some reports, حتى لا يبقى منه شيء, up until nothing is left of it. والعياذ بالله. Right? He says, وجماع هذه الأسباب يرجع إلى ضعف البصيرة والصبر. يعني the collective reason, يعني there could be many reasons, but then what gathers together all of those reasons, right? جماع or جماع, right? What puts together all of these reasons, right? It refers back to weakness of insight and patience. Someone has weak insight, basira, weak knowledge, right? Weak insight and weak patience. He is not as knowledgeable and not as patient as he should be. This is why Allah praised, subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah praised أهل الصبر واليقين. Allah praised the people of patience and certainty. وجعلهم أئمة الدين, and he made them the imams, the leaders of the religion. فقال تعالى وجعلنا منهم أئمة يهدون بأمرنا لما صبروا وكانوا بآياتنا يوقنون, and we made of them imams, leaders, pioneers. They guide by our command. يهدون بأمرنا. They guide by our command because when they were patient, because they were patient, and because they used to have certainty. They were certain of our signs. Surah As-Sajdah. So you want to be very strong, you need to have certainty, and you need to have patience, right? With al-yaqeen, certainty of faith, you will repel and push away the doubts, misconceptions about the deen. They tell you the religion is this, the religion is that. Terrorism, killing and killers and chopping the heads and, you know, the women and the status of women and. With knowledge and certainty of knowledge, certainty of faith, you will repel all of these misconceptions. While with patience, right? With patience, you will repel and push away the fitna of shahawat, the temptations of, you know, the lusts. You have desires. Sometimes, you know, a believer would have belief. Who's a Muslim who would think even of becoming a Christian or a Jew? Or after Islam, who would even consider that? Even the weakest Muslim, he wouldn't, hardly ever. How many Muslims, they have changed? Hardly ever. Even those who changed, usually, they were either somewhere, they were raised upon something else. They were not raised upon Islam at all, right? And at other times, it's the second problem that leads them to do that. He wants a certain position. He wants a certain woman to get her and the likes of that. And usually after they get what they want, they don't care about the other religion anyways. They just want to get their, lusts and desires. That's the case, right? So this is the case. Certainty of faith, yaqeen, and asking Allah for that is something that is very important, right? Asking Allah that is one of the most important things. That's why, if you remember, in the book Ad-Du'a by the Sheikh Sa'id Al-Qahtani, we went through the beginning of it, and he was summarizing the most important things that he should be asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of them was this, al-yaqeen, right? Al-yaqeen. Because there is one authentic hadith that says, it was recommending al-afiyah, well-being, that you should ask Allah al-afiyah, well-being. Well-being, يعني al-afiyah meaning Allah defending you, Allah's defense, difa'ullahi anil abd, adi al-afiyah. Al-afiyah, well-being, it means that Allah will take charge of defending his servant, defending him from everything. Ideas that are wrong, humans that are oppressors, and so on and so forth, right? Sorcerers, people who strike with an evil eye. Al-afiyah, you ask Allah al-afiyah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, emphasizing asking Allah al-afiyah, right? He said that one is not given after al-yaqeen better than al-afiyah. Right? So when you ask for al-afiyah, add to that al-yaqeen too. Allahumma inni as'aluka al-yaqeen wal-afu wal-afiyah. Add them together, right? Al-yaqeen, certainty of faith, right? Certainty of faith. And again, you know, the it is suitable to mention once again the hadith of the story of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, who was reciting in the masjid. He was reciting Surah An-Nisa, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to the masjid, and he was with Abu Bakr and Umar. It was the night time, and he was reciting Surah An-Nisa in the masjid, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was listening to him, and he always praised the recitation of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud ibn Ummi Abd radiallahu anhu ardahu fil jannah. And he recited all of Surah An-Nisa. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw that Abdullah started making dua. He was saying, sal tu'ta, sal tu'ta. Ask, you will be given it. Ask, you will be given it. Right? So in the morning, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu went to give the good news to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. So he found that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu already beat him to give him the good news. Like the usual, he always beats him in everything, right? So he asked him what he was saying, what was his dua, right? Some of the duas that we get, they are from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and some of the duas, they come from the Sahaba themselves. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, because they were so close to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, their statements and actions, they're coming from that. It's a glimpse from that source. That's why you find their statements has light on it. It has light on it. Although it's a statement of a companion, not the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But then it's coming from that source. So anyhow, they asked him what kind of a dua he was making. So he was saying, Allahumma inni as'aluka imanan la yartad. He was asking iman that never reverts, never breaks, never retracts, never goes back. It will always stay, always remaining, fixed. Right? La yartad. Wa na'iman la yanfad. Enjoyment that never finishes. And murafaqata, being in the company of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, fi a'la jannati al-khuld, in the highest garden of perpetuality, radiallahu anhu ardahu fil jannah. He was asking that. So we need to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us faith and to increase our faith and to give us yaqeen, to give us the certainty of faith. So many in the Quran and in the Sunnah, حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا واجعلنا هداة مهتدين. Right? اللهم زيننا بزينة الإيمان. So many in the Quran or in the Sunnah you find this dua of increase in iman and also guidance. Guidance is, you know, being guided. One part of it is the having the iman and the certainty of faith. So back again, someone believes in the next life, believe it is true, believes in paradise and the hellfire, yet his deeds are not up to the level. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned this. He said, ma ra'aytu kannar, I have not seen like the fire. Nama haribuha, the one who is running away from it goes to sleep. I have not seen like the fire. The one who's running away from it, yani if you run away, you need to you need to be awakened, you need to be alert, you need to run away from it, not sleep, right? And وَمَا رَأَيْتُكَ الْجَنَّةِ نَامَ طَالِبُهَا, I have not seen like the paradise. The one who is seeking it is also sleeping. The one who seeks it is asleep. Right? So he says that this could happen. The fact that someone believes, yet his deeds are not up to the level required, yani by his belief, by his faith that he has, is not strange. What is the reason? weakness of knowledge, weakness of faith. This weakness that is يعني it's already there and you add to it. Someone is not reflecting, someone is not calling to mind this faith that he has, right? يعني سبحان الله in the Quran about the servants of Allah that are so sincere, مخلصين. Allah mentions that he made them sincere by the remembrance of the next life, ذكر الدار. Imagine every time, all of your day, you are always remembering the next life. You remember death, you remember paradise, you remember the fire. How many times this comes to our mind, right? On a daily basis, right? So the one who is always remembering this, his heart will become very soft. And his sincerity will be sharpened, will become very sharp and exacting, right? Because he remembers the next life. So after mentioning the weakness of faith or knowledge, you don't call it, you don't recall it, you don't call it to mind. Add to that all of these other distractions, then you believe, yes, but then you are not acting according to what you believe in. And those causes, you can combine them all or you can summarize them all into two things. Lack of basira, lack of knowledge, sure knowledge in the religion, lack of insight, right? And the lack of patience. Because seeking knowledge needs patience. And being withholding and controlling your senses, your emotions, your feelings, your desires needs patience, right? So if you fail on one of these two grounds, then this is how you are lagging behind. As for the imams in the religion, those who want to be leaders of faith and in religion, then they have to have both the sure knowledge, insight, basira, and they have to have the patience. The next, inshallah, point he moves on to is emphasizing the difference between having good thought or good expectations from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and being fooled and deceived. The true hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the difference between that and just mere wishes or wishful thinking. So I think we will stop here. We'll leave that for next week, inshallah ta'ala. And we can pause now. If you have any comments or questions, or you want to.
The question is yesterday you taught us weakness. The iman is the who awwal wal akhir wal zahir wal batin.
Mm-hmm.
And how about this alone? So,
yes. Yesterday we were doing the book Hisnul Muslim. And that one, that section that we did yesterday, the one who is struck with doubts in faith as from the whispers of the shaitan. And the example that was mentioned is from the hadith itself, that the shaitan comes and says, Allah created the creation, so who created Allah? Right? So Rasulullah ﷺ advised us what to do when we have this kind of evil thought. And this is only inspired or one of the prompts of the shaitan, right? So Rasulullah ﷺ taught us as to يعني, what to do in this case. And that is to basically seek refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the shaitan, the accursed, to spit to your left three times and to say آمنت بالله ورسله هو الأول والآخر والظاهر والباطن وهو بكل شيء عليم. الله أحد، الله الصمد، لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. So this is regarding those doubts that may happen to any one of us, and those are just evil prompts of the shaitan, basically. I did mention though that the scholars mentioned that if those doubts are coming from or stemming from lack of understanding in a certain area of the religion, then you need to spend the effort to learn what it means, right? And therefore, this way you will treat يعني, the disease of ignorance with the cure of knowledge, which brings us back to the very beginning of الداء والدواء, when he was talking about that there is no disease except that it has a cure, and one of the diseases is the disease of ignorance, and then you cure that through seeking knowledge. Allah knows best. But this idea, when it comes, Allah created the creation. Who created Allah? I didn't mention that he would stop, right? You stop this because there is no way of going through this. You just have to stop, desist. That's it. Just stop thinking about that and stop going on with those ideas, right? Allah knows best. Yes. Yes.
How much iman is enough? How do I know that I have enough of it?
There is no limit to that. The more you do, the more you go up the ladder, right? The less you go down, right? So there isn't a level where if you reach, you say, I reached that level, that's it. There isn't.
How do I know that I have sufficient?
You look at the description of the believers, and if you see that you have those, then alhamdulillah. If you don't have them, then you need to work on that. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. The believers are only those whom إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. If Allah is mentioned, their hearts tremble with fear. وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. If His verses are recited to them, they will increase them in faith. وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. And they totally rely upon Allah. Right? So, as-salah, zakah, they spend from what we give them. And the rest of the descriptions of the believers that are found throughout the Quran, right? So if you have those within yourself, then alhamdulillah. If you need to increase some areas, then you need to increase those areas. You look at the description of the believers and try to actualize that within yourself. Allah knows best. Yes. تفضل.
من خلق الله وخلق
الكون السماوات
السبع؟ كيف نسمع أنفسنا نقول هذه الجملة؟
لا أتصور أني أقول
هذه الكلمة.
صحيح. How can we say who created Allah? That is a reality that happens because of the shaitan. That is why some of the companions, when they came to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they told him that we have things, we feel things that we cannot even talk about. Those ideas come to us. Even one of them, he said, for him to turn into a burnt piece of coal, يعني فحمة يعني حمامة, is better for him than to even say it. Right? And he was saying to them that is explicit faith, يعني صريح الإيمان. This shows that you are a true believer, that this idea is not even passing. It's attacking you right, left and center, but then you can't even, يعني you don't want to even talk about it. right? And the same that man who came to Abdullah ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما, and he said, ما شيء أجده في صدري, what is it that this thing that I find in my chest? He said, is it something that is doubt? He said yes. He doesn't want to even say it. Then he told him to say, هو الأول والآخر والظاهر والباطن وهو بكل شيء عليم, right? So this is the case. تفضل.
Just a comment, يا شيخ, on this topic.
Mm-hmm.
This thought has crossed, of course, the minds of the hearts of Christians.
Mm-hmm.
Any doubts that I've had in the past, I've gone in and searched for the religion.
Mm-hmm.
And normally, it increases my belief. It makes it more solid. So when that thought came to me, I looked throughout the Quran and the hadith, and Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, and Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala can, ولم يكن شيء قبله, وهو الأول, فهو دائما, يعني كان دائما موجود. We have to accept this. Because if you say, who created it? Okay, who created it? The one who created it, or who created it, you understand? So there has to be that ultimate power, you understand? So that way you could, you know, تطرد الشيطان. فأقول أحمد بالله, this is what I found that kind of strengthened that.
Yeah, of course. And this is what Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم يعني taught to say, يعني الله أحد, الله الصمد, لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد, right? You repel this with this iman. And Abdullah ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما, he advised that man to say هو الأول والآخر والظاهر والباطن وهو بكل شيء عليم. And just for the benefit, that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, it is reported from him that he used to recite المسبحات, the surahs that has سبح, يسبح, سبح, سبحان, right? He used to recite them before going to sleep, and he said that within them there is an ayah that is better than 1,000 ayah, right? Now, it's not mentioned in the hadith which ayah is that, but according to Al-Imam Ibn Kathir, he says that that ayah is هو الأول والآخر والظاهر والباطن وهو بكل شيء عليم. The meaning of it is so deep, and if you read, inshallah, the books يعني pertaining to the names and attributes of Allah, and see what they say about this, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he explained those. And he used to also, in his dua before going to sleep, he used to use these names. Allahumma anta al-awwalu falaysa qablaka shay, wa anta there is nothing before you, wa anta al-akhiru falaysa ba'daka shay, you are the last, there is nothing after you, wa anta al-zahiru falaysa fawqaka shay, you are the zahir, there is nothing above you, wa anta al-batinu falaysa dunaka shay, you are al-batin, nothing can veil you. You are closer to everyone than he himself. Allah is closer to you than you yourself. Right? هو الباطن. So if you read the meaning of that and expand on it, you will see that the meaning in there is so deep. Is so deep. And it will bring a lot of يعني إيمان, and a lot of يقين, and a lot of comfort in your heart, إن شاء الله تعالى.